Hello, everybody, and thank you for joining us for this Sherpa interview. I'm Marianne, and I work for the European Business Summits, and I work on the Sherpa project regarding advocacy and dissemination of the recommendations that have been put forward. We are joined here today with Patrick Breyer, who's a member of the European Parliament in the Committee on Civil Liberties, Justice and Home Affairs, and also a digital rights activist who has been very outspoken on everything regarding artificial intelligence and compliance with human rights and fundamental rights. We're very happy to have him here today with us to discuss our findings and our recommendations. And I will leave the floor to you, Ben, to introduce our viewers to the Sherpa project.
Okay, thank you. So Sherpa is an EU project that focuses on questions of ethics and human rights in AI and big data, what we call smart information systems. This is an interview in a series of interviews with decision makers, policy makers, people who are involved in determining how these emerging technologies will be used in the future. And we are, as Marianne just said, delighted to have Patrick here with us to get some of his insights. So Patrick, first question to you, maybe you could give us a little bit of a background of your work, if you want to, for example, on the Committee on Civil Liberties, Justice and Human Affairs, and how that affects your views and your insights and understanding of what AI is doing, should be doing, and how the AI policy on a European level is being developed.
Well, thank you very much for having me. We are dealing with the issue of artificial intelligence, what should really better be called machine learning. In the European Parliament for 2 years now, there is even a special committee dealing with it. And in the Civil Liberties Committee specifically that I'm a member of, we are working on a report on the use of artificial intelligence for law enforcement purposes. So this is something that we're looking at because law enforcement in the past has really been a human activity with human oversight and human measure. But if we're moving toward in the direction of automated enforcement, that creates a whole new situation that our legal framework is not made for. And also when it comes to specific areas, especially in the judiciary, using algorithmic decision support mechanisms. So even if the machine doesn't take the decision, but will suggest decisions in the judiciary, that really runs counter the idea of the judiciary as a system where an independent judge will take all circumstances of the individual case into account to take a decision. And that's why in the draft resolution that we are working on, we say that the judiciary should not be using algorithms to propose decisions to the judiciary.
It's a well-discussed topic, and we've seen in America that these systems exist and are being used. I guess a follow-up question would be, where do you draw the line? I mean, I'm sure you wouldn't mind a judge using a word processor to type up the judgment. At what point does the system become too autonomous or too intransparent, or what exactly are the issues that you're worried about where you say this is where we shouldn't go?
So when it comes to law enforcement in general, the red line is crossed definitely when it comes to mass surveillance. So when the personal data of anybody, of non-suspects, is being processed and analyzed, just in case they might have the intention or have committed a crime. Mass surveillance takes away our freedom because people, if they are being watched, they cannot really behave freely, and they sort of self-censor. And that's why this needs to be ruled out. And there is already clear legislation on it as well. And when it comes to the judiciary specifically, we haven't ruled out the use of machine learning in the judiciary altogether, but only when it comes to specifically proposing judicial decisions. And the reason why this is so important is that even if the system only makes a proposal, it has psychologically what we call an anchorage effect. So even only seeing a proposal will sort of anchor the issue and lead people to find their final decision around this, not too far away from this proposal. And that's why even the proposing mechanisms are a great problem. And as I said, the very idea of the judiciary is to weigh all aspects of the given case. And that's why it cannot be reduced to a limited number of factors resulting in some number. The judiciary is not statistics. And if it was about statistics, we wouldn't need the judiciary.
Okay. Another question with regards to how we regulate AI. We all know that the EU is about to publish the regulation. It's going to come out in next week or so. And within the Sherpa project, we've also looked at regulatory suggestions, what's out there, what in different member states and worldwide people are looking at. And one of the suggestions we've come up with is that an agency of some sort, a regulator, whether we want to call it a regulator or an agency, that there should be a place where enforcement might be combined, but also where insights, where knowledge around AI would be held. What do you think about this sort of, and of course, in the regulation, or at least in the white paper, the Commission has suggested that should be done on the member state level. So there should be a network of regulators who look after specific issues like the ones you just mentioned. So how do you think this should best be organized? Should this be, do we need a regulator? If so, would it have to be a European one, a national one? How do you think this could be worked?
Okay, so why do we need a regulator? There will be requirements in this legislation when it comes to the areas where we don't want algorithmic systems to be used at all for. I already mentioned mass surveillance. There's also profiling. There is dark patterns influencing elections, et cetera, pp. But there are also requirements that will be imposed, requirements to the training data, requirements regarding the transparency of this data and of the code that is being used, on the explainability of decisions. Maybe for certain harmful technologies, there will actually be ex-ante approval procedures, so where certain mechanisms need to be approved. And of course, when it comes to the government use of algorithmic systems, there will be special requirements and there will need to be special requirements. I already mentioned the area of justice. There is also the area of lawmaking. There is also the area of law enforcement, et cetera, pp. And so the authorities, the competent authorities, will have to look into the use of machine learning, determine whether it's lawful or not, determine what needs to be changed, determine whether sanctions are needed where legal requirements are not met. And of course, as a matter of the principle of subsidiarity, it makes sense to have these authorities as close to the citizen as possible at member state level. But we've also seen in the context of the General Data Protection Regulation, where a one-stop shop mechanism has been established. That means concentrating enforcement to the member state where the data processor is established. That this is resulting in problems because many internet companies are established in Ireland and the Irish Data Protection Authority is not acting as it should. It isn't taking decisions for years, et cetera. And that's why we need to also come up with some coordination mechanism and some way that when no decision is taken or can't be taken at member state level, that there should be some central point of decision, be it the Commission itself or be it a specialized authority at EU level.
Coming back to something you touched on earlier, namely the question of biometric surveillance, and that's something that you, I think, feel strongly about and you're trying to make sure it doesn't happen. That makes no perfect sense. I think that there's a lot of support for that on the state level, so we don't want the state to do broad-scale biometric surveillance. But how do you deal with the fact that a lot of citizens give their data, including biometric data, to big social media companies who then use it for purposes whichever they like. So how do you deal with this disconnect of, on the one hand, we're worried about biometric surveillance, on the other hand, we give away data, including biometric data. And how would you regulate the social media companies or other related organizations' use of such data?
So the fact that social media companies just wanted to go ahead and start biometrically analyzing images in photos and videos that have been posted, that resulted already in the data protection authorities intervening and prohibiting Facebook from doing that. So according to the General Data Protection Regulation, if a private entity wants to process biometric data, they need to have either exceptional circumstances or the consent of the person involved. So you can only do this if the person actively consents to this happening. They can't just scan and match everybody's faces, which is important because your biometrics are something attached to you permanently. And if they are leaked, it will be possible to impersonate you. And there is nothing you can do to change your biometric appearance. It will always stay the same. And that's what makes it so problematic. So while the GDPR rules out mass surveillance by private entities, because it makes it depend on consent, when it comes to law enforcement, there is no such clear ban. So the EU does not tell the member states you can't use biometric mass surveillance for law enforcement purposes, for example, at sports events or at protest marches where some law enforcement authorities have started to use these technologies in Hamburg, for example, in Germany, which is highly problematic. There has also been trials in Berlin to use this technology at train stations. And it has turned out that even at a small error rate of something like 0.1%, there are still so many false positives. So people falsely reported to the police for being wanted, which they are not, that actually about 99% of the hits would be false positives if these systems were used on real life passengers. So these systems result in massive false incrimination and also in discrimination because they recognize people of color and certain people that are underrepresented in the training data less well, which means that the error rate for these groups of people will be even higher than for the general public. And since we don't want public spaces to be under permanent surveillance because people cannot behave freely if they're being watched and monitored and possibly reported all the time, we need a specific ban on biometric mass surveillance for law enforcement purposes, and the EU Commission should propose legislation to that effect. That is the subject to a European Citizens Initiative, which is called Reclaim Your Face. It needs 1 million signatures so that the EU Commission needs to consider it.
Okay, thank you. I think we've gone through our prepared question. So the last question to you, now that the regulation proposal comes in next week and this is a hot topic, what would be your most important wish, desire? What do you think should happen in the immediate future in order to address AI, machine learning and related technologies?
I think if we want algorithmic systems to be in line with our values and rights, then we need to ban the unethical use of these algorithmic systems. So what's important to me is that this is not just about requirements and regulations, but that this actually says these are the use cases where we don't want algorithmic systems to decide, where we want humans to be in charge of, where we don't want statistics and probabilities and profiles to decide, but we want decisions to be taken in individual cases and on the merits of every one of us separately. This is important to me, and I will critically watch the proposal to see if it lives up to this. I'm not sure it will. And I think that the European Parliament likely will need to thrive to make this proposal better, to make sure that our society and our values are preserved, even in a world where algorithmic systems are ubiquitous, really.
I'd like to thank you all very much. And in particular, of course, you, Patrick, for taking the time.